Okay, hello and welcome everyone to today's event. I'm Jason Gompert from MS Dynamics World, and we are here for a new session on Azure Machine Learning and its application for Dynamics AX. I'm really glad to be able to welcome back Alex Anikiev of Microsoft for today's event. Alex has done a number of sessions with us in the past. Maybe some of you have been on those as well, and they are always really interesting and a lot of fun, and today will be no exception. We've had a great response for today's event, and I expect it to be another really great look at some of the future and current technology that Dynamics AX users and professionals can be applying to their solutions. I know Alex has a very full presentation planned, and I want to get right to it. So as we get started, please know that you can add your feedback and ask questions using the Q&A block that you should see to the right side of the presentation window. And a few questions are actually already coming in. Alex will be leaving time at the end for those. So without further delay, Alex, I will hand things off to you to get started.
Thank you very much, Jason. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. So very excited and always good to be back and present here for MSDynamicsWorld.com. So I'll just begin right away because we do have...
Alex, I think you went on mute. Hold on 1 second, please.
Mm-hmm.
Are you there now?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, now we hear you.
Okay. So I guess I will skip all I talked about while I was on mute, and I will just get right into the session. So Jason explained what the session roughly will be about. So we'll go through Microsoft Azure Machine Learning and how it applies to Microsoft Dynamics AX. We'll have, basically, this will be structured into multiple logical blocks. One will be going through Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio, and we'll see how you can create experiments, what's kind of behind the scenes with the Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio. The second piece will be focusing on the practical application of machine learning for Dynamics AX, specifically in the area of demand forecasting. So we'll review, we'll dig one level deeper into how demand forecasting is implemented in Microsoft Dynamics AX and how what role machine learning plays in it. And then we'll also, along the way, we'll also discuss how we can work with the different types of data. We'll provide scenarios and examples in different industries, how machine learning applies there. So how to work with data, how to interpret results you get in from machine learning. And just to give you guys some level of comfort so you can actually go and implement your scenarios using machine learning, not necessarily using something standard, but maybe for your customers, for, again, our customers and partners can implement some unique scenarios for themselves. So the general context of why am I doing this, it's in the context of the scenario, and I've been doing this scenario for a long time now. This is in the broader area of enterprise IoT, the Internet of Things, and obviously machine learning plays a very important role in the big picture of what you can do with enterprise IoT. And this is the scenario I've been working on, and I've been blogging and posting detailed walkthroughs how to implement basically scenario involving Microsoft Dynamics AX in the area of lean manufacturing, as well as Microsoft Dynamics CRM, and then how to equip, let's say, pieces of machinery with the different sensors and how to collect this data and so on. So that was a very detailed scenario. And as a part of the scenario, what we can do, and this is just one application that I will kind of bring up front, machine learning can be used for predictive maintenance of those assets that I was considering in my previous articles. But the application of machine learning is much wider, so this is what we will delve into right now. So in terms of the domain, so first we'll begin with theoretical knowledge and some background, and then this will help us to progress through the presentation. So machine learning is a scientific discipline that explores the construction and study of algorithms that can learn from data. So again, just to rephrase it, we can say that we can predict future by looking at the past, how we, by looking at the data in the past, by looking at historical transactions, let's say, by doing this, we can better structure our knowledge in certain domains, and application of machine learning spans across multiple domains, multiple industries and areas, as well we can get some meaningful business insights. And then when we work with machine learning, we will generate some results, some data, and then the ultimate goal will be to somehow visualize them and start making sense of the data we obtain. In general, we can divide machine learning into two big categories, which is called supervised learning and unsupervised learning. And then I can also tell you that in supervised learning, if you go to Machine Learning Studio right now, you will see two types of algorithms available, and it's a multitude of algorithms under those subcategories. So one subcategory is regression, another one is classification. And what it allows you to do in supervised learning using regression classification algorithms, in this case, you typically know your kind of subject domain. You know what data you're working with, you typically want to predict data in the future, which is numerical data or a non-numerical data. But you're pretty much comfortable with the data you're working with. As opposed to unsupervised learning, in these scenarios, you'll be lacking some good knowledge of the data, and you will be looking at the system to provide some meaningful insights, like, okay, so how do I approach this data at all? So maybe I don't know this data completely. I don't understand how different meaningful variables correlate between each other, like what's the interconnections. But I know something, and this something I will build into the model and have system coming back to me with the result. Maybe it will be clustering, like grouping some types of data into clusters and highlighting them for me, and I can make determination what to do with that. Or maybe the second option is in unsupervised learning is anomaly detection. So maybe you have some set of data, and some pieces of that data will be kind of anomalies, and you want to spot them, you want to work with them in a special way, and do something with it. So that lays out the foundation of what machine learning is, what the purpose is, and what categories of algorithms we'll be working with. Then, of course, more than like 80% of people, they perceive information in a visual way better than the audio, right? So that's why I put together this small visual for you, so we can see like machine learning, supervised, unsupervised, regression classification, clustering, and anomaly detection. And then you can see the visual depictions and illustrations of what it means. Like in the case of regression, you basically will have some numeric values, and you want to build the trend line. This is the very simple scenario with the linear regression. So you want to know like what happens in the future, what value you will get in the future based on what you have been getting in the past. In classification, in the case of classification, maybe a good example would be you have multiple different types of data, and you want to kind of classify them into buckets, if you will. So that's the easy way to understand classification. You can see that I divided basically the set of circles from the set of axes on this visual to show you how we can classify into buckets. With the clustering, so you can see it's easy to understand how we can cluster different data into multiple clusters, and then there's a wide application of what you can do with that. And anomaly detection, it's obvious, like you have a data which falls into the general pattern, the general behavioral pattern, and then some of the pieces of that data will be outside of that general expected behavior. So you want to very quickly spot them and work with them. Now we'll speak about, like, we're getting closer to the machine learning, Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio, and we'll speak about what you will be working with, the project. The project in machine learning terms and in Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio is called experiment. So you can build your experiments, and in general, again, without overloading you with the details, so what experiment allows you to do, it allows you to combine in a very easy to use drag and drop canvas It allows you to combine different elements, how you work with data, how you, what mathematical model would you like to apply, what steps, how you transform the data, and so on. So you can build your experiment from building blocks, which are available in Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio, and then connect those blocks and organize the consistent flow that will give you the result. And then if you want, looking a little bit forward and projecting this to a demand forecasting scenario in Microsoft Dynamics AX, you can see that there are multiple steps that you have to take, typically you have to implement when building a machine learning experiment. So you will train the model, you will score the model, and you will evaluate the model. And I will explain what it means. When you train the model, you feed the model with the data from the past. When you score the model, you specify like, okay, so this is the types of data based on my historical data. Let's say it has multiple columns in it. And I may be predicting some quantities of my sales demand in the future, right? So coming closer to demand forecasting scenario. So when I score the model, I say, I actually want the system, I want you, the system, to come up with the predictions for that particular column, which is in this case will be, let's say, quantity. So when I score the model, the system comes up with the result of prediction. And then when I evaluate the model, which is an optional step, but as you predict, of course you predict into the future, right? So then you will actually transact in the system, and then you will see whether your prediction was good or it was not so good. So then you obviously want to enhance your prediction in the future. So that's why evaluate model step allows you to compare your prediction with the real results, and then basically come up with a deviation and say, okay, so my algorithm worked good, but not too good, or I want to enhance it, and then you can tweak your algorithm and make it work better in the future. So that's the general schema. And then if you want to project this to what's happening with the demand forecasting in AX, so training and scoring of the model happens during generation of statistical baseline forecasts. So when you run this procedure in Dynamics AX, the data will be fed into the machine learning model, the scoring will happen, and then the results in forms of quantities will come back to you and will be displayed in the user interface. So that's just a very simple way to look at experiment. So before I get into experiment and I have a live demo for you guys to see how you can build your experiment, I want to go through mathematical models and just to provide you with the kind of show you what the ground we cover, how many algorithms are available, and then what will be the ultimate application of the results obtained from the mathematical models under Microsoft Azure Machine Learning. So the first algorithm I mentioned in supervised learning was regression. And we have multiple algorithms available in Machine Learning Studio, and those are displayed on this slide on the right-hand side. So we have different kinds of them, ranging from like a very simple linear regression, which is just building basically a straight line, the trend line, and then based on this trend line, we can predict the future. Or something more interesting like a Bayesian linear regression or boosted decision tree regression, decision forest regression, or like neural network regression, and Poisson regression and something like that. So the level of sophistication of those algorithms will be different, and all of them are provided. So you don't need to, obviously the value proposition of machine learning is that you don't need to implement all those algorithms. So if you look behind the scenes, like if you would want to implement those algorithms on your own, which I actually did for multiple of them during my during the time when I was preparing my PhD thesis. So that was a time-consuming exercise, believe me. And now Microsoft packaged this as a service for you, and then you can consume. You can just in a very simple drag-and-drop interface, you can consume it on the website and build like a pretty much amazing experiments, giving you working with a huge amounts of data and giving you amazing results. So coming back to regression. Regression analysis, like in this situation, I use an example of machine logs. So let's say I have a piece of machinery, and I'm collecting data, let's say about quantities produced on certain machines, and I want to basically based on my, and I know my business and the way my factory operates, it's predictable. It's like it's a stable operations. We have a maybe stable demand, maybe sometimes we have some spikes in demand and so on. But I, nevertheless, I want to predict numeric values of how many products my machine will be producing, and each machine may be different, right? So maybe may have different throughputs and may have different calibration settings and so on. So as I apply a regression algorithm to the result of my machine log, which consists of multiple values such as quantity, machine, time when this product was produced, what product was produced, then I can actually get some interesting insight in Power BI, and this is just the end result. And then I will show you, again, when we get into the weeds of how to create experiment, I will show you how the model looks like. But that's just from the perspective of what algorithms are available and how the potential end result may look like for when you predict numerical values based on machine log data in terms of quantities produced. Classification, in this case, I actually use the same example of machine log, but in this case, my machine log also provides data about my like stoppages of my machines or some unexpected behaviors or breakages or power outages or something like that. So actually I want to take this and I want to analyze, I want to produce, like do event analysis, and I want to predict non-numerical values. Maybe I want to predict how many power outages based on the historical operations I will have. Let's say in during last year I had like 10 of them or 12 or whatever, and it's very costly, so I want to predict it. And I want to predict, I may predict this based on particular machine, based on particular type of event, based on particular different types of data that will be present in my data set. So imagine that machine log may have multiple types of data in there, and it's technically it's your decision to decide what's meaningful for you, and then you will be predicting based on those non-numerical values, putting those predictions into buckets. Let's say I did maintenance, failure, success, and power, and I want to know what will happen in the future based on how I did in the past. And then for classification, we have also multiple algorithms available, and I actually used, for this example, I used multi-class decision forest, but there are plenty of other things, and some of them may sound funny for you, like a decision jungle and so on, but it's actually a very serious mathematical algorithm behind this. So this is classification and how we can use this for event log based on event analysis based on machine log. Then in terms of clustering, so this is, we get into kind of uncharted area when we may not know all about the data we work with. And clustering scenario, which is a part of unsupervised learning, may help a great deal when you, let's say in my scenario, when I have same machine log, and I want to actually, in this case, I know that some machine operate well, some machine operate not so well, or even badly, and I need to do something with it, maybe some maintenance or repair. So actually in this case, based on performance of my machines, and I use the example from the previous, I use the data obtained from the previous example of event logs. So now I have failures, maintenance, power outages, success runs per machine. So can I now cluster those machines into two clusters? And presumably, one cluster will contain good performing machines, another cluster will contain bad performing machines. And I can define what criteria I use for determination for this clustering, right? So in this case, it's a success, a number of success runs versus number of failed runs. So very easy to read, and you can see that my performance analysis shows that when I run my machine learning, it shows me that it clusters those machines in two clusters. So I can easily see that basically based on my success, which is x-axis, and then failure, which is the y-axis, I can see that three machines were classified as a kind of high-risk machines that I potentially can do maintenance on, and two machines are performing well, so I can, again, keep monitoring what's happening, and then when I run this procedure again, maybe this reclusterization will happen, and then I can make appropriate decisions and do preventative actions. So that's clustering. And finally, anomaly detection. So that's very easy to understand. So you have a normal behavioral pattern, how data kind of behaves. And you can also do this, like it's very easy to see on the graph. Like if I have, let's say in this case, my quantity produced, and maybe it's the situation with operator log. So let's say my operator provides feedback in terms of reported finished quantities. And then sometimes operators do mistakes and make mistakes, right? So I want to capture this erroneous data entry so this will not skew the results of my, I don't know, like demand forecasting or something else. So I can easily apply, based on the criteria that I put inside of my model, I can easily apply anomaly detection algorithm, and I can basically fish and spot all the anomalies. Like in this case, it's a negative quantity of a large negative quantity that you can see easily on the graph, but imagine you have millions and tens of millions or hundreds of millions of records, so it's not so easy to detect, right? But if you run this through machine learning, it's so easy for machine learning to process this data and give you just exactly what you're looking for in this haystack of data. It will find this needle for you, and it will say, this is what you have to be looking for. And again, you can display this on the Power BI dashboard, and this will be so obvious to consume and so easy to use. Now switching to the live demo presentation of Machine Learning Studio, so we'll see basically how those experiments look like, and we'll answer a couple of questions like, how do I create a new experiment? How do I use mathematical model for this? How do I work with the data, and how, when my machine learning experiment runs, how do I interpret the result? So I will use an example of regression, and I've prepared already, this is the machine learning area on Windows, Microsoft Azure portal. And then basically when you create your workspace, then you can sign in into Machine Learning Studio, which looks like this. So I will, just for the sake of time, I'll just get straight in there. And then I have multiple algorithms implemented. So one is called regression, another one is called classification, then I have a clustering algorithm. You can review basically on the right-hand side how the actual model looks like. And then I have anomaly detection. So if I dig deeper into my regression algorithm, so let's see what it consists of. So then you will see that we have those essential pieces of the model, like when I train the model, when I score the model, when I evaluate the model. So just like on that slide that I showed you at the beginning. But now we actually dealing with something which is highly interactive. So this is the drag and drop canvas, and you can compose your experiment. So in this case, I'm getting my data from the CSV file, maybe Excel file, CSV file, maybe the data coming real time from the web service, which is exactly the case with the demand forecast and how the data gets passed to machine learning from Dynamics AX. And then also we have we define like what values from that data set we'll be working with. So I can review the data set. And this is how my data set looks like. Then I have project columns, which basically defines what meaningful columns from that data set I'll be working with. So this is the selected columns. I know that there is a correlation or interrelation between product quantity, transaction date, machine, and color for my prediction of quantity of quantities produced. Then I say, okay, so some of the data I will use for training purposes. This is my historical data. It's 84% of that data, which is the fraction of rows that will go on the left into training model. It's 84%. The rest of 16% will go into the scoring. So that basically means that I don't have the data. That's what I'm trying to predict. And then when I train the model, I say I'm training the model to answer one basic question: what the quantity will be in the future. So that's why in the column selector I can select quantity as a selected column for prediction. And then I apply mathematical algorithm to this, which is the linear regression. And then linear regression will have some parameters which I actually did not change, so I left it as is. When my model is trained, then I can say, remember that 16%, those five rows specifically from that Excel file, I will have to predict based on that. So when I train the model, I feed this knowledge into scoring model block. And then basically the evaluation of the model is the optional step, which allows me to, when I have my data in the past and when I have my actuals, I can compare and I can come up with the delta of what my deviation was from the reality. And I can kind of organize the feedback loop, and I can potentially change my algorithm or change my parameters for that algorithm to reflect my business better and get better insights. So if I go to the a blank experiment where I did not go far here, but I'll just show you the mechanics of what you typically do. So let's say split data. So I will just do this, and then I already specify that this is the data I will be working with. So I will say, okay, so I'll connect this data, and I will split it as I did, like not 50-50, but maybe like 84% or 86%, whatever you want. And then after this, you will basically be looking for a train model block. Here's my train model. And then I will also need score model. And then I will also need something like a linear regression. So this is how easy it is to apply your and create your experiment. And then obviously when you add your linear regression, then you can connect this with the train model, connect train model with the score model, basically feed this data into the train model, feed the rest of 16% of data for scoring, and then organize all of that, save it, and then run it. So I will just run it from here quickly on the existing one and show you the results, and we'll move on because of time. So this is the fully built model, very simple one, but at the same time it gives you and me very meaningful insights. Like based on the historical data, I can build a regression trend analysis and come up with the prediction. So I ran the model by clicking on the run here, and then I will basically go and visualize my results. When I visualize my results, in the score label column, you will see that this is the predictions. So basically, initially I had zeros here, which is, I did not know what it will be to produce blue speaker on this date on this machine. But based on my historical performance of that machine and my demand, those are the values. So this will tell me that it's roughly like three items, roughly two, roughly four, roughly five, and roughly two. And then you can visualize and see it very easily. And then obviously, you can turn this experiment into a web service by setting up a web service. When you do so, it will basically generate a separate experiment for you, which I did here. And then basically here you will see there's a web service input, web service output. You can associate parameters with this web service input node. And this is what, when you consume this web service as just another web service from outside, from AX or from your other system, you will specify what parameters you want to run this experiment with. You will specify what data you want to use, not necessarily static data from here, but data coming from the Azure blob storage, let's say, or data streaming into machine learning web service as a part of the web service call. And then again, once you get the result, you will consume this result back in your application, being Dynamics AX or another application. And then this way you can leverage the power of Microsoft Azure and Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Studio to build your experiment, expose this as a service, consume it, and what took in the past like hours and days and weeks and months to build, now it's conveniently packaged by Microsoft as a service and exposed to you for consumption. So it's a very nice value proposition. So we actually saw how you can answer all of those questions, and we'll move on. And I discussed already what it takes for exposing machine learning experiment as a service. And by the way, if you want the ultimate level of detail, so actually I have a blog post on this topic, which is quite lengthy. So my blog posts usually look like mini books. But at the same time, if you spend, I don't know, like enough time reading through this, you will understand from A to Z how to deal with the subject, and then you will get to the result. So all of what I'm explaining today is described in a very high level of detail on my blog here, and you're welcome to review and you're welcome to apply this for your projects and for your scenarios. So coming back to my presentation. So I will try to keep it quick here, but it's quite amazing and quite interesting. Like I got, I have a colleague of mine, and we've been working together before, and we keep in touch right now. His name is Jack Moran. He's a manufacturing expert and a supply chain expert, And he always gives me interesting questions. Like, so I posted the blog post, and Jack came back to me with a question, like, can I apply similar exercises in a common manufacturing problem associated with production cycle times in AX? And I've broken down this question into multiple pieces. And if you look carefully at the highlighted pieces here, so what Jack is asking and what Jack is explaining here is that we typically in production flows in standard manufacturing or in lean manufacturing, we have some values introduced based on predicated on best guesses. So that actually speaks to expert knowledge. Sometimes in the company you have some people that they've been working there for like 25 years and they say, like, I know better. I don't need any mathematics here. I know better. But in order to kind of step to the next level and next level of quality, next level of performance, sometimes and oftentimes the expert knowledge is not enough because you need to see what's coming, what's happening, how you interpret those results and so on. So that's where we kind of coming from with this question. And then Jack is saying that we want to refine those guesses. We want to differentiate and maybe differentiate those cycle times by resource operation that may need some attention and also make some suggestions. And also if something falls outside of the acceptable range, then we want to kind of block it. We cannot use it. So I've actually broken down this into multiple pieces, like expert knowledge I explained, then how we can apply machine learning in this scenario. We can apply like regression algorithms to make suggestions about what it will be in the future based on your past performance, right? It's hard because with machine learning, we're looking backwards into the history, so we can only make some suggestions based on the knowledge that we gained in the past. But it's hard for us to step forward with this, right? Also, with the anomaly detection, we can also identify what cycle times may need some attention, right? So maybe there's a deviation from the regular behavioral pattern, and we can spot them and say, like, okay, so with those work cells, or with those production units, we need to fix the problem because they underperforming, they overperforming, whatever. And then also there's the concept of optimization here, because the whole idea of like refine those guesses. I mean, there is maybe a mathematical algorithm applied to optimize. And when you optimize, you typically like minimize or maximize your objective function, right? So in this case, we want to minimize our cycle time, but still keep it reasonable and keep it within acceptable ranges, which introduces some constraints. So on this simple slide, with this simple question, I mean, it has not simple answer. So It explains how we do it today and how people used to do it today. It explains how machine learning can be applied and what limitations machine learning may have and how we may want to apply optimization algorithm based on constraints, like it's a constraint-based programming to minimize the cycle time. So the answer to this question is yes, we can apply machine learning, but optimization would be even better. And what would be even better than better is to combine machine learning with optimization. That's why I have this slide, which speaks basically, which explains in more details what I spoke about just a moment ago. So basically machine learning is about learning to do better in the future based on what we experienced in the past. We have optimization, we have different algorithms available, like falling into ranges of linear programming, quadratic programming, mixed integer programming. Maybe it's an NP-full task which does not have a deterministic algorithm for resolution, so we'll apply some heuristics. And then I'm providing examples like the product configurator in Dynamics AX is an example of the constraints-based optimization. And then price optimization would be another one. This is the example of how the function looks like for machine learning, right? So we know this is the function, this is the pattern this data should kind of comply against. And this is the classic simplex method or linear programming mathematical model when we maximize something and do with the constraints. The actual benefit applies and appears when we apply this in a hybrid algorithm approach. When we combine machine learning with optimization, which means, let's say a good example is demand forecast. We apply machine learning to predict demand, and then we actually feed this demand into price optimization engine, so our marketing department can come up with the right pricing structure for our products based on the demand, right? Because it's a demand supply. Like if demand is raising, then potentially we may want to increase the price and so on. And this is what the major companies in retail in other industries do. They basically monitor all of that, and they do use hybrid algorithms, and this is where they gain the most benefits from. So I guess, again, thank you very much for Jack to kind of posting this question, because it's very important to understand the distinction and how we can combine all together to get great results. Now we into demand forecasting. Very exciting topic. We've got some great enhancements in demand forecasting in Dynamics AX, in new Dynamics AX, comparing to AX 2012 R3. And speaking about mathematical apparatus, we have, this is the quick summary of mathematical models available. So we began in 2012 R3 with SQL Server SSAS time series based algorithms being ARIMA, ARTXP, and mixed. This is on the left. And then we basically, with the machine learning, with the introduction of machine learning for demand forecasting purposes, we got some more algorithms available. So we still have ARIMA in its purity. We have all, which is the best fit model, which basically the system decides itself what algorithm to apply. And then we have some interesting things introduced. The exponential smoothing, that's what people were asking for a long time. We do have it. It's just the benefit of having machine learning and standard way of implementing exponential smoothing and machine learning. We just apply that natively to the demand forecasting. And then we also have a STL, which stands for seasonal trend decomposition procedure based on loss. So again, you have some descriptions if you want to dig deeper. I don't want to overcomplicate with the mathematics here. And then we have some combinations, ETS plus ARIMA, ETS plus STL. So the bottom line here is that we've got more options, more flexibility. You will be able to get better results. With the help of machine learning, which is the service in Microsoft Azure, this will be fast, this will be more accurate, this will be better, it's only benefits that I see from introduction of new algorithms and new paradigms in demand forecasting. Then we'll not spend too much time about discussing how to configure machine learning for demand forecasting in the new Dynamics AX. But just to give you some hints, basically it's quite intuitive when you don't have this set up, you go to demand forecasting parameters, will give you basically the message. You open up this message, you will see instructions. So then there are a couple of things. First is what web service endpoint address to use. So when you go through this link for Dynamics AX7 demand forecast and you deploy this machine learning model, you expose this as a web service, and then you will go basically, let me see if I have this open. I do, I think I do, yep. So basically, if I go to my model here, and this is what I deployed under my workspace. And if I switch to, I already deployed this as a web service. So if I switch to a web service view, you will see you can click on a go to web service. This will get you here. Then you have an API key that you can copy into the settings. And then you also have, basically, if you go to request response, you'll also have this request URI. And request URI, you will only be interested in getting this piece, right, without execute. So you're not interested in this. You're interested in this as a request URI that you want to put as an endpoint address. And this is exactly what I have here. So workspaces are roughly like XYZ services ABC. This is what you put here without this piece, without something that I haven't read. Then you have a web service API key. And then you can also use a storage account. And what's interesting, and let's see if this is my next slide. I'll probably explain this very quickly while I'm on this topic, and then I will switch to what we do inside of demand forecasting, how we operate. But before that, I will do this piece. Yeah. So what are the benefits of using Microsoft Azure for the purposes of demand forecasting? So obviously, this is about cloud computing storage, and they go side by side. And if you look at, if you assign, so there's a setting that allows you to reassign your storage account to a separate storage account, And if you do this, and if you want to look at what blobs will pop up as you execute demand forecasting, you will see actually those blobs in Microsoft Azure portal under your storage account that you specify. And this will be, if you open up this blob, this will be exactly like this. So you will see the granularity attribute, date key, transaction quantity, and so on. So those are the model and the way we work with the data and the mathematical model the concept of mathematical model did not change. It just now we leverage Microsoft Azure and its storage capabilities to basically house those blobs, and then those blobs will disappear as demand forecast procedure completes its run. But it's just so amazing to be able to see like how Azure is used completely in its completeness to implement this scenario. So not only the compute and the web service piece, but also the storage is used behind the scenes. So I wanted just to highlight for you, and so you can better understand the value proposition of Azure for demand forecasting and Azure ML. So now we have time to discuss how demand forecasting works, and that it's been some changes in the way it works, like in terms of steps involved in this. And let me just go to Dynamics AX, and I will just open up my generate statistical baseline forecast. So actually I will go to master planning, so let me do that. So where's my master planning here? Yeah, here's the master planning, and then we have demand forecasting, multiple steps involved. So generate statistical baseline forecast. No conceptual change in the meaning of this step compared to AX 2012 Part 3. Then we have adjusted demand forecast. So what we used to do based on SQL SSAS cube and Excel on top of that to adjust forecast. Now you can actually adjust this inside of Dynamics AX. So once you generate statistical baseline forecast, you can open this up, the adjusted demand forecast. So let's just do a quick run through. So basically this is what I did. So I assigned a D product, which is the standard demo data item allocation key for grouping of my products. I assigned this as a parameter into machine learning. I set this up against ML web service. Then I'm basically running against demo data in USMF companies. So I have time ranges here. I specified that my forecast horizon will be 12 months. And I run this procedure. So I'll not do this for the sake of time. When I run this procedure, I will get my statistical baseline forecast generated. And when I go into my adjusted demand forecast screen, there are a couple of things I want to highlight. So first of all, you can adjust straight from here, right? So you can do it like this, and it will highlight for you nicely that this is what you adjusted. It was 323, now it's 325. Then also what you will notice is that once, right? So for this piece, for a different company, because I'm running this in multiple companies, and I have this product which comes up with the demand forecast of one. So actually it's a brand new product, and in 2012, in AX 2012 R3, in order to do demand forecasting for brand new products without transactional history, you would need to do some tweaks. And I explained this in my previous blogs. In new Dynamics AX, you don't need to do any tweaks. It just comes up with once really nicely. So I found this very useful. And then also from here, you will adjust your demand forecast. You can also see like demand forecast lines details, which shows you a nice graphics and nice, it's a very nice form for analysis. So you can see the graphical analysis if you wish. And I'll just close this out. So you can also do manipulations in Excel, right? So this is what people are used to. So you can do like, you can click on this Microsoft Office button. You can do aggregated demand, and it will give you, basically it will open up Excel, and it will, behind the scenes, it will be appropriate DIXF, Data Import Excel Framework, business entity, exposing this data, and you can manipulate with the demand forecast. Once you've done this step, you can actually There is additional step involved, which is called authorized adjusted demand forecast. This comes very handy when you have multiple people involved, when you have one person who is supposed to be reviewing this, and you can assign appropriate permissions to generate, adjust, and then somebody else will approve it. And then as you approve this, so again, this procedure also, everything is logged, so whoever is doing this, so I can specify, like, this is my, on behalf of my user, I'm approving, I'm authorizing this adjusted demand forecast. Once you do this, you will actually get results in results back as in the form of demand forecast in Dynamics AX against products. So I will go and this is my product that was included in my item allocation key, and then I can go to demand forecast. And obviously, what also people would expect, you can also open it up in Excel, and you can edit demand forecast, which is displayed in this form, in Excel. So if you prefer to do this in Excel, you can do this in Excel. You can also do some additional calculations on the separate tabs, which is the benefits of Excel and formulas, and then you can push this back to Dynamics AX, or you can do this adjustment inside of the screen in the web browser, right? So this is, I can also adjust like sales quantities here if I want. Then I also have some hints in terms of how you operate with Excel. So let me come back to my deck and I will explain again, just to give you guys some hints and practical advice. So you can run this in batch, you can run this in interactive mode. By looking at messages, you will see when this statistical baseline forecast will be generated. Speaking about Excel, so I sometimes get questions from people like, how do I manipulate forecast in Excel? I try to open this up in Excel and it doesn't open. It just loads in the data connector forever and I cannot use it. So basically what you have to be looking for, and this is what I showed you on the adjusted demand forecast. If you click on the office button, shows the aggregated demand, it opens up Excel. If you on the demand forecast screen, if you click on the office button, it shows you an option to edit demand forecast in Excel. So when you click on that button, edit demand forecast in Excel, in the dialog, you can open in Excel, right? So if you just download and if you open, so by default, this workbook will be in the read-only state, which means that you have to basically enable connections, you have to enable editing, you have to enable all of that in order for data connector to connect and in order for data to be displayed and you'll be able to publish. So what you can do easily, you can save this workbook instead of opening this right away. You can save this workbook on your desktop or anywhere and then open this up, enable editing, enable connections. Enable this Excel add-in if you're using this for the first time, and then you will easily connect and you will be able to manipulate with the forecast. And this is how it looks like in the reality. So I will just open up. This is the one that I downloaded, and I saved this. So now you see that actually I have to re-sign in, but if I do. And let me see, I just want to show you this piece to give you a level of comfort that everything is working, everything is perfect. So let's see if this will allow me to re-sign in very quickly. Retrieving registrations, retrieving metadata, it will pull out the data right now. And then what you do after this, so here is my data, there is a connection to the appropriate source through data connector, which is the Excel add-in, right? And then I can go here and I can say, sales quantity is 407. Actually, I changed this yesterday from 406 to 405. And then you can do publish. And then basically publish successful. So now if I go back to my Dynamics AX, and if I refresh this screen, or if I go back to my demand forecast, I can show you this 407, which came up, came from, maybe I have to refresh. Let's see if I can do that. Or maybe I'm looking at the wrong data. But anyway, so this works. It's verified. Yesterday it was working. And let me try again just to make sure that I'm using the right product here. And I'll refresh again. 407. So this is supposed to be 407. I think that's the right figure here, if I'm not mistaken. Depending on what I was modifying, but it works, and it's just a matter of finding the right record in the right on the right form. So you can easily, by using Data Connector, you can easily publish your results back, and you can manipulate with the demand forecast the way you used to from AX2012 for three times. Let's see what we got left here. And I will speed up because I'm running out of time already, and I appreciate you guys staying with me and listening. So I will speed up, and then we'll open up for Q&A. So a couple of things before I wrap up. In terms of results, I'm also getting a lot of questions about like what's the best algorithm to use. So essentially, we have multiple algorithms. Different algorithms are suited better for specific purpose. Let's say speaking specifically about like simple case. ARIMA, ARTXP, and MIX. This is more like looking back when we had just three in the times of AX2012-43. So ARIMA is short-term. It's suited better for short-term prediction. ARTXP is suited better for long-term prediction. MIX actually combines them too and decides what algorithm to use, like a best fit model, right? So you may go with the mixed and get good results, and it's also subjective based on what you see and how you apply your kind of expert knowledge by looking at the results produced by demand forecasting based on algorithm selected. But actually, if you savvy enough, you may find that more precise algorithm like short term, specifically ARIMA or specifically ARTXP, may be getting you better results. And I actually did this small experiment in Excel. So I actually captured results from three runs on the same data. When using ARIMA, ARTXP, and MIXED on probably it's like a couple of years worth of data. And actually you can see that the short-term kind of suited ARIMA is more reactive algorithm. So it spikes up very quickly. And then the ARTXP is actually predicting with a more stable pace. And when I applied MIXED, actually MIXED adjusted to ARTXP for more long-term prediction, because we have like a time span of multiple years here. But if you would be predicting on the smaller scale, let's say by week or by day, depending on your scenario, obviously ARIMA would be more reactive. It would give you better results to reflect the situation happening. Plus, of course, you can apply all your kind of insider knowledge that you may have in the domain. We spoke about that. Excel add-in. So this is the final piece of my presentation. I will actually show. So one of the questions is, okay, so I have plenty of data in AX. So how do I test? How do I approach this at all? Like, how do I see this working? Like, can I test this on a small subset of data? And obviously, when you run this through Dynamics AX, it calls machine learning web service behind the scenes, so you don't see what's happening. I mean, you can review what's happening in the blob storage as I showed to you, which is just for your understanding. It's not that you do this normally during operations. But if you want to touch it, if you want to feel it, actually there is the Excel add-in that allows you to connect to machine learning algorithm and web service, and allows you to use sample data or introduce your own data. And then actually from within Excel, you can run your prediction and see the results. So let's see how it works. So I have this another Excel, and obviously with my knowing that I'm in love with Excel, so obviously every time I open Excel, there is an Excel add-in for everything I do. So in this case, you can see that I use the data from the sample data, which is embedded into machine learning algorithm. There is the use sample data magic button here to bring this to the canvas. And then I actually predicted, and this is my prediction for the rest of, I think it's like more than a year, because I'm predicting monthly. So it's 12 months worth of prediction based on five months worth of data. So date key represents month. Granularity attribute represents company, product, as well as all its meaningful dimensions included into the forecasting. And transaction quantity represents the actual quantity, historical quantity if it's here, or predicted quantity if it's here. And then also we get information about what forecast model was selected, because by default I'm selecting all, like a best fit model. So actually it selects exponential smoothing here. And then the granularity attribute, again, what for each granularity attribute, I may select a different forecasting model. So let's see how this works in Excel, because this can be a great help for somebody who wants to test how machine learning works in Excel. So I'll basically select that this is my data, which is right here. Then I will select that my output will go into A10. And my output 2, which will describe what algorithm I use, will go into A20. And then I will also say that parameters will be just, I'm passing empty parameters, so I'm accepting standard parameters, kind of hard-coded parameters that I have in this experiment. So when I say predict, actually, this is what happens. So it gives me, actually, I had to do this vice versa, but anyways, so it gives me the result. It gives me the ETS, the exponential smoothing, was used for this particular product with its dimensions within this company. And this is my predictions. And I can see, I mean, from here, I can visualize this in Excel. It happens to be because the data set is very small, like 5 records only to predict 12 months worth of data. So obviously, it just flattens it and makes it into a straight line. But nevertheless, if you have more data, you can enter this in Excel and you can run this through Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Excel add-in. And the connection, to establish connection, is very easy. So add a web service and the way you set up for Dynamics AX, the same way with the API key and with the endpoint URI, you specify it here, and then you can get comfortable within Excel with the Microsoft Azure Machine Learning, and then obviously apply this knowledge in building your own scenarios or using demand forecasting in AX better, and do whatever you want with this. And I think with this, I'll just give you a few examples of what I've been working on recently, and I will wrap up. And I'm already kind of behind the schedule. So please know that we have plenty of algorithms already implemented in Machine Learning Studio. When you create new experiments, you can actually create one from sample and then modify the sample for your needs. So there are plenty of examples for predictive maintenance. That's what I was working on recently, and I was building something on my own, as well as was using examples and templates provided by Microsoft. So example applications in the energy sector. So pipeline management or performance analysis of pipelines. So if you have pipelines and it's like a lengthy, it's a large territory of pipelines that you have to manage and you have to maintain. So there are mechanisms how you run some certain devices through the pipe and manage and monitor its state, or some on-surface inspection that you do and identify what sections of pipeline require maintenance or require substitution and so on. So with the help of machine learning, you can actually monitor and prevent and do preventative as well as, I mean, all the way to predictive maintenance and get a lot of benefits. And then also, like, if you look at, like, oil and gas industry and the refinery example, like, refinery shutdown is a multi-million exercise. Like, it's a loss of potentially a loss of million of dollars. So if you can do, like, a refinery shutdown prevention based on condition, which also falls into predictive maintenance bucket. So that's another great example of how machine learning can save you millions of dollars potentially. And then obviously the very sound example that we get from retail, and this is what Microsoft had been using in Microsoft retail stores with MPOS based on Dynamics AX. So this is called recommendations, the product recommendations, and this is available in Microsoft Azure Marketplace for consumption. You can just simply sign up and you can begin feed this model with the data and organize correlations between meaningful variables, and you may consume it inside of MPOS just like this. And there's a huge application and obviously a huge benefit. You can also review all my information, all that I spoke about today in my blog. And I have 1 minute left. And again, I will leave you with this. If I will be posting additional blog posts on demand forecasting in new Microsoft Dynamics AX soon. I have plenty of material on machine learning already there. So any feedback you have, any focus areas you want me to potentially kind of pay my attention to, it will be much appreciated. And I certainly appreciate your attention. And again, special thanks to Jack Moran for his great questions leading to additional thinking and great outcomes. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Alex. Great job. And we are right at the top of the hour here, and I know you do have kind of a tight schedule today. Are you able to take any questions right now, or should we perhaps save them for after the event?
Yeah, because it's a my mistake, so I was too excited to go over time, so I will definitely stay. I can stay 10 more and discuss. And,
okay,
and again,
great.
For those who stayed with us, thank you very much.
Great, yeah, and thank you for taking the extra time, and we have a few questions that come in. A few people have asked about getting either access to the slides or access to the information that you presented today, and I think, like you were saying, we can send out information to everyone who registered with a link back to your blog, and that would probably be the place to watch, right?
Yes, so that's the best. So recording will be available. Blog is the step-by-step instructions. If you want this deck specifically, I'll be glad to provide it to you. I think if you reach out directly, and I'll be glad to provide.
Okay, great. Yeah, and if anyone just wants to put a request into the Q&A, we can make sure to get a note of that as well, if need be. And I see a few people have done that, so thank you. So here's a question, Alex. How would replaced or discontinued items be dealt with in AX7 when it comes to demand forecasting? In other words, an old item sold often but then discontinued and replaced by the manufacturer?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So let me think. Obviously, you control, like, the way you group it, it's through item allocation keys, right? So at some point, but you still want to, it's like when you stop it for production, but you still sell it until you exhaust your stock, right? So I guess the best way would be to, again, maintain until you exhaust your stock, to maintain this as a part of the item allocation key. You may move it to another item allocation key just for, like, to have something which is stable and something which is on its way out. And then at some point you will realize that there is no stock left. So you cannot really plan demand, you cannot really sell anymore, so you will just exclude that item allocation key from consideration. So it's more like a phased approach, how you can slowly begin, and it depends, like if you exhaust the stock quickly, this will happen quickly. If you exhaust the stock within a few years from now, you have enough stock to be selling, not producing, but to be selling for a year or two, then, I mean, separation on the level of item allocation key, that's what I see. Maybe there is a better way, and I'll take a note of this. If something else comes up to my mind, I'll share with you. Thank you.
Okay. Another question. If making an adjustment to a forecast, does it keep the original forecast plus the adjustment, or does it just overlay the values?
Yeah, so we should be keeping we should be keeping original and adjusted.
Okay. What's the best way to load sales history from a legacy ERP system that we want to use when cutting over live to Dynamics AX? Can we use the Excel add-in for Azure Machine Learning and the use sample data capability to load the legacy sales history into Excel?
Yes, it's a great question. So the best way in general, the best way to manage data in Dynamics AX is DIXF, Data Import Export Framework. The real question is, like, are you using this solely for demand forecasting purposes, or there is another, like, what other systems do you use? Like, maybe there is another system that you use for reporting and so on. But if you want to keep everything inside of Dynamics AX, and you want, let's say, 2 years worth of history to begin with in AX, with demand forecasting, I would use just a data import export framework to introduce this data into AX. The way you actually introduce it, it depends as a part of your data migration. Because just putting history into transactional tables, this is not how we do it, right? So we do it through journals, we do it through, but the mechanism will be DIXF. If you want Excel,
okay.
Excel is still not suited for large data sets. So DIXF for large data sets. If you want to use Excel, it's more for more manageable data sets. That would be my recommendation.
All right. Can you plug in new assumptions that are not, a new assumption that is not part of the historical data, like a new machine?
New assumptions, meaning, so I guess I will need clarification. Is it relative to the data or relative to a mathematical model? So whatever comes with the data, and data kind of speaks for itself, right? So if you have some historical data for a certain machine and which describes its behavioral pattern, then it may be used inside of AX for demand forecasting, because it will have its reflection in transactions. But if you want to change your mathematical model without customization, you cannot do it. So demand forecasting, yeah. The actual mathematical mechanism, if you look kind of under the hood, it's the actual algorithm is implemented in R, which is the statistical language. And I actually, if you were attentive during my presentation when I used Excel add-in, I actually had a note that I modified algorithm and I hard-coded some values for the purpose of testing inside of R. And then I redeployed the web service. So you have access to the R, but it's considered as a customization of the machine learning model.
Is there a significant growth in Azure cost the more data we feed into the models? And if so, should we try to trim data?
Yeah, so, and the purpose of this blob storage illustration was exactly for this purpose, right? So we do leverage storage as a part of demand forecasting execution. The beautiful thing is that it's leveraged as a medium, right? When you execute the procedure, the system puts those Excel files or CSV files into a blob storage. When it ends the execution of machine learning algorithm, that blob storage will be released. It will be cleaned up. So there is no like a permanent storage, kind of permanent charge for you, if you will, as you execute more and more. In terms of the moving large data sets, obviously, I mean, you want to, if you can work with the manageable data sets, and maybe if you have a gigantic data set, maybe you can split it by company, by forecast model, by something, right? By and run this kind of multiple within boundaries of different forecast model, right? So this will help you to manage execution for the best performance and so on. If it's logical to do in terms of how you have your data structure. But there is no additional huge cost incurred by using storage, because it's used as a middleman, right? So in order for machine learning to execute the data which sits in the blob storage, and then it gets removed.
Okay. In AX 2012 R3, the demand forecast functionality uses the standard cube. Does the new AX machine learning use a similar approach?
No, we use right now in, oh, let's begin with AX 2012 R3. So with AX 2012 R3, the data that you exposed in Excel for correction of your demand forecast was residing in the cube. And then Excel was looking at the cube, and then you would modify the cube. And then when you transfer demand forecast into AX, there was a separate step, right, that would go and grab the data from the cube and then introduce this into demand forecast in AX. With the new Dynamics AX, you don't see this step. You don't see the transfer. You see the adjusted forecast and additional step for authorization of adjusted forecast. And the beauty of AX 7 is that you can do manipulation in a web browser. So you don't need to do anything else. I mean, if you want to use Excel, when you open this up in Excel, there is an appropriate DIXF entity which is looking at AX tables and works with this data. But there is no additional step required. So that's the enhancement we've got with the new AX.
Okay, I think we maybe have time for one more question here. Is there any connection between ML Studio and Power BI? Is there a way to consume ML model experiments through a Power BI dashboard or tiles?
So, and this speaks to, I think it's a question which is close to the question that I was explaining, like expectation versus application. If you remember, machine learning and optimization. So in this case, we kind of combining and we asking about machine learning and Power BI. So machine learning, imagine that machine learning works with the data, which may sit in the cloud, right? So this data may sit in the cloud, in the blob storage, maybe it's another type of data which sits in the cloud. So this is on the one side, but there is a data in the middle, right? And then machine learning works with it to produce some results. Then if you imagine on another side of the spectrum, you have Power BI. Power BI may also work with the same data. So Power BI needs data, machine learning needs data. So in ideal situation, what happens is that machine learning helps you to generate this data that Power BI may be using. But machine learning also needs some data to begin with, right? So like transactional. So I see actually Power BI and machine learning as the siblings. It's not like, they may use the same data source to work with. So that's why, I mean, asking if we can consume machine learning data in Power BI, I mean, we can, because machine learning generates that data that may be consumed in Power BI. So I hope this makes sense. I mean, when you have a data which is, let's say, Dynamics AX database, and then machine learning may work with this database to manipulate the data, even if it's like through a middle tier. And then Power BI will be working with the Dynamics AX data the same way. And again, there's a middle tier that provides the way how Power BI fetches the data and how Power BI caches the data. So think about Power BI machine learning as the siblings working with the sum data. And in this case, the answer is kind of yes. I mean, obviously, the reason why you execute machine learning is to generate data that you then present in Power BI. And that's exactly what I did. If you remember my slides, regression, classification clustering, and anomaly detection. So I did not explain to you what happens, how to generate that data, but I showed you what the data, what the end result may look like in Power BI.
Great question there, an interesting answer, something certainly people are going to be looking at going forward. We are at time right now. We had a lot of great questions, and we do have a copy of all of those for anyone who didn't answer. We'll hold on to those and see what we can do. Alex, thanks so much for taking the time today to present to our audience. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Jason, for inviting, and it's always great, and it's always a pleasure for me to be here.
Awesome. I hope we can have you back soon. And thanks to everyone in the audience for your attention, for your great questions. As always, we really appreciate that too. With that, we are going to end today's event. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.